Hello everyone, Science Viking here, and I'm ready to start the next part of our Let's Play of Myth of the Fallen Lords. Let's see what's happening with the volcano.
Sunday, December 7th, Seven Gates. The Watcher drove his army without rest through the fleeing remnants of Rabican's forces and into Seven Gates. We are there now, inside the pass.
Rest?
Where he then clashed with the Deceiver on his way east. The bodies of the undead are everywhere, melted and broken. It seems inconceivable that anything could have survived. I don't know why he attacked the Deceiver, unless somehow he found out what was going on in Silver Mines. One of the veterans said that these two had it out after the Battle for Tyr 12 years ago, and that the Watcher barely survived. I have a feeling the real reasons for what happened today go back even farther than that. Whatever the case, while the battle raged only a few miles away and we thought the Watcher was coming for us next, I was glad nobody had asked me to carry his damned arm. It looks like the volcano will keep Seven Gates open through the winter, so Maeldun is sending out patrols to retake the pass. The Legion's growing fame seems to draw danger like a bright candle attracts moths, and if any of the enemy survive the floods and fighting, I'm sure we'll be the ones to find them. So ends the 17th year of the war.
You know, from that narration, I get the sense that things are going poorly. Anyway, we're back to using warriors for this level, and we still have six motion. And yeah, that's
easy. They're fighting each other.
I was about to say that. That's the main gimmick of this level, is that there are actually two factions within the enemy that are fighting each other in addition to fighting us, making things significantly easier. Of course, you may notice we don't have any dwarves, so we're going to need to exploit the fact that they're fighting each other in order to handle them. Also, this is going to be our first real encounter with a Shade. This time we actually have to kill him ourselves, we don't have Ulrich to bail us out. Anyway, before we go and take on the Shade, I'm going to quick get us a fresh recording file. I don't even know what word that was supposed to be. So I will be back in a second. I'm just going to quick kill the Soulless first. Try and minimize the damage to our Well, we took no damage. I guess that counts as minimizing it. Well, back in a second. We have ourselves a fresh recording file. Continuing to use my old microphone because, well, I still don't have my new microphone.
Sir?
So, there is some strategy in terms of choosing which enemies to kill and which enemies to spare to prolong the conflict. Basically, you want to attack the side that is doing well, but for this initial fight, there's really no way for any of these enemies to be a serious threat to us, so we can destroy all of them. And just keep moving everybody along. Yeah. We have a decent pool of veterans this time because obviously we have warriors, and warriors weren't in that disaster at Silver Mines. It's nice to see that the least experienced warrior we've got has... Oh, he has one level survived. I thought he had more than that.
We're moving. Sir?
We must have got... Based on his coloration and his number of levels survived, we must have gotten him at Flight from Covenant. Like, he was new as of Flight from Covenant, because only that level in Homecoming give us warriors with the green and brown coloration. And then he wasn't in... The only level after that in which we've had warriors was Bagrata, and I'm guessing he wasn't in Bagrata because he wasn't very experienced, and deliberately picks more experienced guys.
Ready.
Now, another thing you may notice we don't have is dwarves, which is significant because there are quite a few thrall in this level. But there is a trick to dealing with. And to exploit that trick, I need a volunteer. And I have decided that you are my volunteer. You have volunteered, whether you like it or not. Now, the way it works is, we need to go this way, on this bluish rock path. That's just the direction the objective is. Now, down this way is a fairly strong force of enemies. It has a good number of soulless, quite a few thrall. We could beat it, but it would be pretty challenging. However, along this path, we don't actually need to go this way to advance through the level, but down this path is a different, pretty strong group of enemies that even has some fetch. These two groups of enemies are not on the same side as each other. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to send this warrior down to get the attention of the group that's up here in the far north, and then have him lead them into this group. And then the two groups will fight and mostly wipe each other out, and we kill the handful of survivors.
Yeah.
Somehow this group has already taken damage. I don't know how that happened. And they're already coming after us. With how uniform that damage is, it might be that the script made them start the level damage. They do that sometimes. Kind of to add some flavor, if a group isn't really fresh and has been fighting for quite, has like in the narrative been fighting for quite a while, then they will, you can start the level with them having already taken some damage to kind of make the gameplay reflect that. And here's the other group, along with one thrall who is not part of their faction. Okay, I want to get the attention of both groups. Kind of a difficult challenge of keeping close enough to both groups that they actually try to come towards my warrior, but also staying far enough away that we're out of attack range for the Solus and the Fetch. The way the scripting works is basically, for the most part, they'll go after whatever is closest to them. However, they will prioritize more powerful units over less powerful units. So, Thrall are the weakest, and thus lowest priority no matter what. Solus are stronger and thus higher priority than Thrall. Fetch are higher priority than pretty much anybody, etc. And similarly, dwarves and archers are higher priority. So if an enemy, particularly if an enemy Solus has... Why are you guys not going towards each other? Come on. What's your problem? This is interesting. So if an enemy Solus has an equally clear shot at one of my warriors or at one of my archers, it will go after the archer. If it has an equally clear shot at an archer or a dwarf, it will go after the dwarf. That kind of thing. Melee units sort of do that with their AI, but they will also prioritize closer units by a larger amount. So a thrall will mostly... It will... If an archer is really close, or if a dwarf is really close and a warrior is also really close, the thrall will go after the dwarf. But if the dwarf is even just a little bit farther away, then it's likely to go after the warrior. Because the idea is, if it went after the dwarf, it would probably just be killed before it reached him. Now, I'm still betting on the side with Fetch, but I'm not certain about that. That Fetch works in the ring. We've seen how deadly Fetch can be. Oh, no, the Fetch lost. Alright. That just leaves my archers to mop up what's left. So let's get them into position here. That was weird. I wonder if they saw my force down here or something, because they usually start going after each other faster than that. I think we just had our glitch for this mission. And 10 Viking points to anyone in the comments who knows what that's a reference to. And I'm just going to quick heal this warrior. I'm going for no casualties this time, because honestly, I want to rebuild my stock of veterans, and I want to build my stock of... I mean, I don't need to rebuild my stock of veteran warriors, obviously, but I want to... But I want to build up my stock of veterans as much as I can anyway, and it's relatively easy to avoid losing people in this mission. So, anyway, get my archers into position here, and yes, we're going to arrange another fight. Hopefully it goes a little bit better than it did last time.
Yes, sir.
Because, frankly, this is the last time we can do this. This is the last time we're going to have to actively arrange a fight. But, hopefully we won't lose the warrior. I actually have high hopes for this guy. Alright. And while this warrior heads towards his destination, I can check out how my archers are all doing.
Yes. Sir.
We're doing alright. We have two actually solidly experienced archers who were not at Silver Mines and thus avoided the Purge.
Ready.
And then we have a number of guys who were in Shadow of the Mountain.
Ready.
They were new as of Shadow of the Mountain. And then, since then, they've gained some experience and become decently strong. Mainly, Shadow of the Mountain was basically a turkey shoot, so the archers got a ton of experience from it. Though, that just kind of illustrates the sad state of affairs that we're in. I literally had two veteran archers total who survived that disaster. And they only survived by virtue of not being on the mission, so they were the least experienced guys that I still had. But now, in addition to these guys who are going to get more experienced, we have,
Yes? Yes?
Since we only have 8 archers this time, we had 11 last time, even with a couple of casualties. Okay, this is the long gun melee, so I'm going to wait for this melee to have a winner. And there's actually another force beyond this group that's the force we're actually interested in. And it's the force throwing javelins at that Solus. So, I'm going to go get the attention of the other force quick a second. But, so there are 3 more archers. I think we had some archer fatalities in Shadow on the Mountain, but there are a couple more archers who are kind of in storage who still have experience thanks to the previous level. And we'll see them again in the next level because we get a lot of archers in the next level. In fact, the next level is going to be a pretty good opportunity to rebuild our supply of veterans. Okay. And this group just has... Oh, it has fetch, too. This group would be a bit of a pain to have to actually fight normally. Come on. Okay, they appear to have our attention. Now, let's head for the other group. The group that we're leading them into, which is up this way and was taking out that other group of soulless. It's kind of interesting. I find this level really gratifying because in any level, I really enjoy it when a lot of the enemy forces die. Like, I understand, obviously, that the number of enemies that die in gameplay has no impact on the narrative. The story moves forward the same as long as we complete the objective, no matter how many of our guys survived and no matter how many of theirs did. But it's still, I kind of, like, in my mind, imagine that I'm actually affecting the war effort in a meaningful way by wiping out large groups of the enemy and having large numbers of my units survive and stuff like that. And so it's gratifying to see a fight like this where two groups of people I don't like are trying to kill each other. That's just inherently enjoyable to me. Maybe I'm just weird. Alright, these two groups are getting close to each other. And should start any moment now. In all likelihood, the only thing that survives this fight will be the 3 fetch, but in all likelihood, all 3 of the fetch will survive this fight, and my archers will have to take them out. Especially since both sides have soulless, but only one side has fetch, so I'm betting on the side that has fetch being the one to win. With accuracy like that, how can you blame me? And the fetch made attack kind of hit themselves. Yeah, for the lightning colored team, I'd say that went cool. Okay, let's pull back, and then... Yep, and now a pretty large number of guys appear to all be headed our way. Or not. Are they just kind of returning to where they started from? Okay, let's just have our force advance carefully with the archers in front, because with a decent lead up, we can pretty easily wipe. As long as we can get them out in the open, we can pretty reliably take them out with just our warriors. As long as we have a decent amount of, they have to cover a decent amount of distance. And it's only if they manage to like ambush us or something that there'll be a serious problem.
Ready.
The force they wiped out did manage to eat through a good portion of their guys. this force is a little bit more intact than that force usually is after you do that. Well, this is going to be interesting. So there's more practice for the archers.
Got him!
Okay, one shot is down.
Yes!
Last soulless, and you got one spear off and a mess. Okay, just go straight for the fetch, ignore the thrall entirely. Frankly, the warriors can handle this thrall if it ends up
that. Got him!
But the fetch are the real problem. Especially since the fetch, I believe, move at the same speed that archers do.
Yes! That was mine!
Okay, sigh of relief that I believe that fetch had entered his firing animation when that arrow hit him. And I am just gonna let the melee handle this.
Sir?
In fact, six motion, you specifically go after a different group from the other warriors.
Yes.
So that you can maybe get a kill or two. Because it's a little bit embarrassing how few kills the journeyman has with how many battles he's been in. I mean, I know he's the medic, he doesn't fight too much, but it still feels a little bit embarrassing for him to have been around for that long and have that few kills. I have a feeling that we're going to have him around for a long time. He's been doing well. And I mean, journeymen are hard to kill, both because you tend to very carefully hold on to them and keep them protected because they're really useful and you usually only get one. And just because they actually have a lot of health. They're tougher than warriors or berserks are in terms of how much damage they can eat before they go down. But the interesting thing about this level, you see this plateau, which clearly is very detailed, and they put a lot of effort into designing this plateau. It's even a different color from everything else in the map. They have, like, plants up here that have been very carefully placed, and, we never have to go up here. It serves no purpose whatsoever. It's just kind of there. There are even enemies up here that we could end up fighting. But there's even this separate higher area, so it really makes you think that it's like you're working your way up to the, and at the peak, at the summit of this is going to be something important, and you never have to go there at all. My best guess is that in an earlier build of this level, this area actually did matter, and you had to go here for some reason, and then they revised it so that you don't. Because where we're going and what we're looking for, if you understand one bit of the lore that is never stated explicitly, actually kind of makes sense. Shades cannot travel over water. At all. No matter how shallow it is, if there's any water at all, shades cannot travel over it. This is explicitly stated actually in a fan-made level that I may Let's Play someday. But it's like that rule is never said out loud in any of the main games. But it is present, and you can tell. You will never see a shade move over water. If somehow you end up in control of a shade, which can only really happen in multiplayer on the level, then it will not be allowed to move over water. If you try to lure a shade into moving over water in gameplay, it can't do it. It's never explicitly stated, but they can't. I guess they're kind of like vampires or something.
Yes, sir.
But
ready.
The thing about shades is, but so there's a shade, and you see up here there's this, basically it becomes a swamp after this, and the shade that we're looking for is in a small patch of dry land in kind of a pocket off from this huge swamp. So what happened, you can kind of infer what happened, that the shade, okay, I'm generally on the side of whichever group doesn't have to fetch, and as soon as the fetch is in my line of sight, I'm taking it out. But is that the shade was here before the volcano erupted, commanding various forces of the undead, because the shades are like commanders in the fallen army. And then the pass flooded. And now he's stuck and he can't get out until the water drains away, because the area that used to be dry isn't, and so he can't cross it anymore. So just kind of an interesting bit of, like, what's going on from a story perspective is consistent with the properties that the units have in the actual game, is something I find interesting. Although, an example of that not entirely being true, fetch, nothing unusual happens if a fetch either attacks while standing in water or attacks a unit that is standing in water. So, I guess water doesn't really conduct electricity that much in the Myth universe.
Ready.
Though, I suppose, I don't know a huge amount about this, maybe if you are in a pool of water and are struck by lightning, it wouldn't, like, spread out through the pool of water. I actually don't know exactly what happens in those cases. But, what I do know is there's a fetch, and because it's a fetch, it needs a killing. So I'm gonna give it a killing. May as well get the warriors into position, and it's extremely unlikely that they'll have to do anything. But, may as well. I sometimes feel bad for the warriors with how unnecessary they are. And on this little pocket of dry land is where we'll meet the fetch. So this is the end of the level. Now, fetch, it's a shade. I always try to call them fetch, but it's a shade. I'm not redoing this segment just for that, but that verbal typo. The thing about shades is, you know that dispersal dream ability, that really awesome ability that Ulrich has that he used to wipe out a huge army of Solas and Myrmidons? The contagious exploding ability. Shades have that ability.
Yes.
And they will use it. Their AI is perfectly capable of exploiting that ability to the fullest.
Yeah. Sir?
So we can't risk attack him with a whole big group of units. We have to very carefully keep our units separate from each other, because if they get too close to each other, he will hit them with dispersal dream and they'll all die. Shades will usually not attack a single unit alone with a dispersal dream, because they only get three of them per level. So if he went after our units one at a time with it, he would take out three guys and the rest could just dogpile him. The other thing is, he will usually not use dispersal dream on any group of enemies that are in melee combat with him, because he would damage himself and thus he would die, especially since he's already low in health. And he's down. And this warrior took that much damage from being in melee combat with a shade. They hit very hard in melee. And that's the end of our first interaction with a shade. It will not be the last time we have to fight a shade. And they will continue to be highly dangerous. And as we can see, our archers inflicted the vast majority of the damage, but the journeyman did inflict 0.3%. We are gradually replenishing our supply of archers. We have our two who are already at least somewhat experienced, and then two more who are actually really starting to shine, having 15 and 13 kills respectively when each one of them has only been around for two levels. Anyway, that's mostly the end for this part, but I did actually record a bit of bonus footage. The bonus footage is what happens if you try to go after a shade using normal tactics, so like the archers in one big clump and then the warriors in another big clump to attack him, and why you really do not want to do that. So we'll roll that clip of bonus footage, and then it will truly be the end of the video. So in the meantime, as usual, I love you all, and I'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.
Hello, everyone. Science Viking here for my bit of bonus footage. I'm going to show what happens if you take on a shade the wrong way. I have a fairly traditional formation set up here, actually, for taking on a single powerful enemy or a group of powerful enemies, is I have my archers off here ready to just unload, and then my big glob of melee here ready to charge in. So, let's try this. Got my archers going in, got my warriors going in. Let's see what he does if we do this. He does that.
Casualty.
Come on,
and
casualty.
There go all of my melee units. Well, I still have my archers. Let's see if I can take him on with those. Eventually, he keeps retreating. Eventually, we're going to have him cornered. bastard. And now he does that.
Casualty.
Yep. And that's the end of that level. Come on, end. Or do I have an extra unit somewhere? And that, dear viewer, is why we don't do that. Yeah, 100% casualties. This is what happens when you clump your units together against a shade. Don't clump your units together against a shade. Anyway, that's the end of this video for real now, so... And we get this lovely image of the Thrall drowning one of the warrior, defeating warriors in a shallow pool. Well, that truly is the end for this part. I love you all, and I will see you next time.